Hi, my name is Gayan Randini. I'm a program manager based out of Redmond, Washington, and I work for Microsoft Identity Division.
Welcome. I am Phil Wibbs, a senior program manager for the Microsoft Identity Division based out of Australia. We both are from the customer and partner experience team. Here in this session, we would like to share some observations and best practices from our engagements with customers and partners.
So, Phil, when talking about Azure AD B2C integration with APIs, a few implementations come to mind.
Yes, starting with an Azure AD B2C policy calling an API. For example, when you need to call a CRM database from within your B2C policy, you can secure the downstream API, in this case, using certificates, access tokens, or basic username and password. Also, you'll see an application making a call to an API. You can use access tokens obtained from Azure AD, and we'll get to some of the details of this later in the session. Last, but the most used pattern is when a user from your tenant using an application is making an API call. Well, user taking an action on an application that results in an API call. The user identity is in the token. In this case, think of a banking app making a balance inquiry. We will spend more time discussing this pattern during this session. So, what are the core use cases for API integration? Why is it important for having an authentication strategy for APIs?
Yes, that's a very valid topic for discussion. As the web application evolved, organizations wanted to let new and alternative ways for their customers to access the core data they store about the users. For an example, rather than having to depend on a single website, the native applications, mobile applications became very popular. For example, for banking use cases, the mobile app became more popular than that application. Then came the responsive web applications as a prevalent pattern for accessing the data. In addition, there are new data warehousing type, analytics type, extract, transform, load, or ETL type workloads started coming into play. So when you want to expose the data to applications in a fast and efficient manner, you need a better technology than just a database driver like ODBC or JDBC. So currently, the most popular REST APIs were born as a method to expose the data to the applications. This has come after series and generations of API implementations like RPC to SOAP to REST. And the APIs will keep evolving as the paradigms for API designs and access methods change.
While this is very interesting, there is even more to API integration scenarios. Many organizations commercialize the APIs by participating in the API economy. Instead of your organization building every commercial offering possible with your data, you can let your partners build on your APIs and provide value-added services. This means you're expanding your total customer base and enabling new commercialization opportunities for your data. You can see many consumer financial services that take advantage of this model, from investment recommendations to credit monitoring and targeted financial services advertising. A key thing to note in this complex diagram is that identity is a key aspect of your perimeter to protect your API.
Moving on to the types of API integration, we see two prevalent patterns or ways of implementing the API integration. The first method is applications directly calling an API. This approach is mainly seen in single page type applications where the API is responsible for performing the authentication authorization functions. In the second integration pattern, you inject an API manager between the caller application and the API. When you do this, you could offload the authentication, authorization, sometimes versioning and routing, centralized policy enforcement, as well as caching and optimizations for performance, like we discussed in our previous slide, into the API Manager. This will allow the API Manager to do the heavy lifting rather than each API having to implement the logic and the code required to implement that enhanced configurations.
Talking about authorization, B2C sends an access token to the APIs as an authorization header. This authorization header, as you can see on the screen, is a bearer token. Both Azure AD and Azure AD B2C uses JWT or JOT-based access tokens. Let's talk about the REST API authentication, the responsibilities of the client and the API. The client is responsible for one, token acquisition, based on the OAuth 2 grant type. This involves sending the user through an authentication journey and optional consent process to obtain an access token for the desired resource or scope. And then two, calling the said API with a header called authorization, which it passes that access token. The API is responsible for one, validating the token based on the validation parameters, commonly the token issuer, expiry, audience, scopes, and the actual signature of the token. This information is obtained from the IDP metadata. And the other responsibility for the API is to authorize the subject based on the claims and other rules. Additional claims contain extra information sometimes used for authorization.
Well, to call an API, one needs to obtain a token. OAuth 2 specification defines few methods of obtaining a token. Here, we are going to discuss few recommendations about how or which grant type to use from the OAuth recommendations in your scenario. So if you have a native client, like on a mobile application, the best method to use is the authorization code with PKCE. PKCE is a relatively new addition to the protocol recommendations that allows to inject an additional parameter called code verifier to protect against man-in-the-middle type attacks. If your web application is a traditional web application, you could use the authorization code flow, which is deemed the most secure code acquisition type. If you use a single page application or a SPA application, you could use the implicit flow with PKCE, or you could use the API gateway as the code exchanger.
As Guyan mentioned, for web applications, we recommend the authorization code flow with the confidential client. This is deemed the most secure of the mechanisms for token acquisition. Single page applications, however, commonly use implicit grants to gain access tokens. However, this is now moving towards authorization code flow with PKCE. The last option is to delegate the authentication to the API gateway. This is a special case, which Guyan is going to talk about next.
Sometimes it's easier for the client-side JavaScript to be sent to the browser to get started with without any kind of an authentication. So let's look at how the sequence flows. The browser simply sends an anonymous request to the CDN, and CDN is going to send the JavaScript code to the browser. Now the browser can render the user interface and get started. And if the browser can provide some functionality without getting the user authenticated, then that's fine. However, if the user performs an action that results in an API call, the API call is sent to the API manager. API manager has some kind of a policy that requires the user to be authenticated and or authorized. API manager at that point generates an authentication request that goes to B2C, where the user enters the username, password, credentials into B2C and performs the authentication. B2C in turn sends the code back to the API manager, where API manager performs the code exchange back with the B2C. Now that the API manager has established the user's identity, It will set an authentication session, in most cases using a cookie with the browser. Once the authentication context is established with the browser, API Manager makes a call to the API to actually get the data and then service the original API request. Any subsequent request that comes from the browser to the API Manager will include that authentication session cookie that was set by the API Manager. Thereby, API Manager will be able to service that API request without having to further authenticate the user.
So, Guyan, for this scenario, how should the registration on Azure AD B2C look like? Is this by registering the API Manager as a confidential client?
Yes. So, in this case, you are not really authenticating the single page application as its own entity. You register your API Manager as the confidential client, and you essentially enable a single page application to use the most secure authentication mechanism, which is the confidential client grant. So there are a few additional considerations that we could look at. The first one being looking at the optimal token lifetimes. Out of the box, B2C provides you with 1 hour access tokens. However, it is wise to look at the standard use case of your application. If you are a banking application, for example, if your average user time on the application is 10 minutes, then you could fine-tune your access token validity for 30 minutes maybe, so you give some buffer there. To manage the authorization, an application can depend on the claims available on the token itself, or the application may use some information from the token and make an external call to an external system to find what the authorization for that particular user is. It's better not to fill up the token with a lot of unnecessary data by having to bloat the tokens. When you have an API management layer, you need to do some fine tunings on that API manager to reduce the amount of token validations that happens. One thing you could avoid is having to validate the token every time the application is making a call to the API manager. This is done by implementing a policy on the API manager so that when it validates a token for a period of time, that token is deemed valid. So it generates, for example, a hash based on the token, and then it stores it in a table. If the same token is played, instead of going to validate the token all over again, it will look at the hash, and if the hash matches, then it will let that communication come through. So the last one is still a preview feature as of the time of this recording. What this allows you to do is to let the API get access to more information than what's available in the token that is sent to the application. If you're exposing an access token to the client, anyone who has access to the client can look at the token using standard JWT decoding. However, if there's a requirement where you don't want to expose such information to the client, you can send that token to the API, and the API in turn can use the user info endpoint, and you could have a policy, you could write a policy that user info endpoint will expose the information that the API needs. So maybe in the original access token, it only contains the subject. In the user info endpoint, it is going to give you the subject, the group memberships the user is member of, and roles, etc. Moving on to looking at Azure AD B2C as an identity provider. The default configuration is for the issuer of a token issued by B2C service to include the policy name. There is the token compatibility settings that's available for user flows using the UI and in advanced policies using metadata values so that you could configure it in a way that it does not include the policy, but it includes the tenant. That way, when you want to configure any token issued by the tenant to be valid as the valid issuer, Few advanced considerations to consider is the service-to-service or application-to-service calls that we touched upon when we started the session. The second advanced consideration you have to keep in mind is when you want to do client-to-service calls. This is where you would typically use a client credential grant. When you're using a client credential grant, you need to configure the client credential endpoint as the Azure AD endpoint rather than a policy. What this means is the issuer on that token is set to the Azure AD endpoint, which includes the login.microsoftonline.com/the tenant ID/v2.0, rather than the Azure AD's typical policy name, tenant name slash policy name. What this means is in your token validation logic, either in the API manager or in the API, you need to include the EVO STS or the Azure AD STS issuer in addition to the B2C issuers.
So now that we've covered some of the do's within API integration, let's talk about some of the don'ts.
Phil, why are we talking about the don'ts? What's so important about that?
While some of these may seem obvious, others may look simple enough for one to overlook. It is important that you keep these don'ts in mind while you are designing, developing, and implementing the API security. Let's start with the don'ts to implement your own token validation logic. From the outset, this looks simple enough. However, you need to remember the complexities related to crypto and nesting permutations that you may find yourself in. It is much easier to depend on a standard library that is managed and supported, for example, Windows OWN or MSAL.
So don't use ID tokens to authenticate to APIs. Starting from the single page applications analogy, because in some cases, the single page application itself exposes an API to the client, the client and the service may share the same audience. And it's okay in that particular case to use an ID token for calling an API. However, very soon you will find yourself calling APIs, those are not exposed by the single page application itself. If you don't use the access tokens, you will lose the ability to verify and enforce the audience restrictions. ID tokens will always contain the audience set to the client who requested the token. Access tokens, on the other hand, has an audience that is marked by the target API. By doing so, you can protect your service against potential token replay attacks and gain the ability to enforce audience restrictions.
The last don't is not to validate access tokens on the client side. The access tokens could actually be opaque access tokens or encrypted JWT tokens. The validation of these access tokens should be done on the API or API manager side of things.
Thank you.
Thank you.